tends to be USB. It sometimes happens that the USB port just closes, you know? This has happened a lot. Yeah. If you hook two USB things at the same time, and then your computer is just like, what is that one? I don't know. I don't know.
It's bizarre.
It was very bizarre. And the other one was the USB hub with all the lights in it. And the other one was the interface. And they were like, kind of. Well.
Okay. That was a little better.
I prefer using maybe using the firewire.
Hello, everyone. Thank you all for coming. My name is Scott Rubin. I just want to start by thanking Ed Campion and CNMAT for inviting me to give this lecture today. And this is meant to be kind of more of an informal presentation of work. So I spent the last year with the George Ladd Prize. I went to Paris and I worked at the Institute for Research and Coordination in Acoustics and Music, or EURCOM for short. And there I did a piece for dancer and cello. So I'll be talking about what led up to this piece. We'll go through the piece itself. And then we'll have a... I'll analyze the piece, we'll have a short coffee break, and then there will be a presentation of some of the...
Can I shut this?
Oh,
We'll watch the door.
Yeah,
it should be okay.
Sorry. That's all right. So a quick overview of how I got to this point, the piece itself, the analysis, we'll have a break, and then we'll have a presentation of some improvisation practices that I've been working with over the past year. That started here and it's changed over several iterations. And I hope that some of you are, we'll do a live demonstration with my friends Jacob, Tamara, and Anishta. I would like to welcome them. And hopefully, and some of you would also be interested in participating. Maybe I should have brought some wine to loosen this up, but we'll see what happens. So over the years, I've been working with dance for about 4 years now. The first project I did was in New York, and I've done several projects since. I'll get into, I think, most of these pieces in the presentation, but this is just sort of an overview of what I've been up to. And I've also been active as a performer, myself on stage in various contexts. You might recognize this room. And the picture on the top left was taken in Darmstadt this year in Germany at a festival called the Darmstadt Summer Courses, where they had a workshop for musicians and dancers. It was the first time they've had dancers at this festival, where we got into teams, and over 2 weeks we collaboratively composed a performance where all the musicians dance and all the dancers make sound. And you learn a lot as someone who is brought up in performing from a sound-centric point of view, but we don't really know how to move our bodies in front of people. James, you remember this show?
Yeah.
So, like I said, I started out, my first piece was in New York, Contra Projections for violin and dance, and then next piece was in Hong Kong for string trio and dance, The Naked to the Sky was in Toronto. And Naked to the Sky was the first, it was the first piece where I used motion-sensitive live electronics, meaning I strapped iPhones to the dancers' arms and then linked them to the computer. It was a very lo-fi design. And I'm going to play just some very short extracts of these pieces.
Thank you.
this guy was the first time I started working with feedback loops. And what that means is when we typically have dancers on stage, the dancers are either dancing to a recording or there's a live band playing. But it's rare when you have situations where the dancer's body or the dancer's movements has agency over the music, either through an acoustic realm or an electronic realm. So that was my first experience with these sorts of feedback loops where the musicians inform the dance and the dance informs the musicians. So how do you notate something like this? It took a lot of collaboration, and it's mainly just text and sharing recordings. I've moved further and further away from notes and rhythms, and I've gotten more into using videos and working in person with collaborators. I feel like it's more efficient for me at least. In 2016, I started a project called Senses, which I think, it was just an exploration of different sorts of improvisation techniques, and it's led me on different paths. And so it led me to Berlin, where I wrote a piece called Ironic, Erratic, Erotic for tuba, dance, and bass. And this piece was, I wrote it in Berkeley, but all the collaborators were in Berlin. So how do you make an interactive piece with people who are far away? So what I ended up doing for this piece was I recorded 20 recordings of myself playing viola. I sent it to the dancer, and then I said, could you make 20 archetypes of movement and send it back to me? So I got 20 videos. I cut the audio of all the videos, sent it to the musicians. I said, I want you to make two recordings each. One that is supporting the dancer, and one that is kind of going against her or adding some counterpoint. So altogether, you have 40 audio clips and 20 dance clips that you can start composing with it and making a map of how are they all related, how can I create structures. And then after that came Define Defile, which is for dancer and string quartet, where it's one of those classic university residency programs where you have one or two rehearsals and you have to get things done quick. So how do you do it quick? So let's do some short extracts. I stopped at 408. Okay. So this is with James and Shoshana Green, and this is in the living room of Anne Rainwater. If any of you know her, she's a local pianist, and she invites artists to just present their work in her living room. So that's where we play. This is Sansan Kwan with the Meebles Quartet, and she is part of the TDPS here at Berkeley. 207. Okay. For the project I did in Berlin, Ironic, Erratic, Erratic, we had 3 rehearsals in Berlin, and I already explained the method that I used to compose this piece. So some of the values that I had while making this piece is I was slowly getting sick of music stands, and I knew that in order for me to reduce the amount of information that would be in front of them, I wanted to write 15 minutes of music or a 15-minute performance on one page. So all the material needed to come from the performers. It all needed to come from their bodies already embodied. And the way in which I communicate the material should be easily memorizable, using memory as a constraint. And I wanted the musicians and the dancers to interact with each other, not with the music stands in front of them. I already explained this to you, but we can go over it again. 20 recordings of viola, go to the dancer, she gives me 20 movement behaviors, goes to the musicians, they do 40 recordings, and then you do your analysis, what works with what makes good contrast, what kind of transitions are we using. And you have the creation of the sound files, which actually came from my viola recordings, but mangled in a certain way to keep the energy but hide the timbre or to mask the timbre. And then the creation of the motion sensor mappings. The score for that piece looks like this. So in most of my work now, the score is less than half of the story. I'm not writing pieces anymore where you can just ship the score out and have it done. I'll never work like that again. I shouldn't say that. I probably won't ever work like that. So as you can see, well, you can't see here because the resolution is not great, but the performers named all of their own files in order to, because I'm not going to name them because I'm not the one who has to memorize it. So they said, okay, this is going to be high arms, everything high, which doesn't mean anything to me, but it means something to them. So we start out with the dancer doing behavior 5 and the tuba and bass doing 16A, fade in slowly. You can really craft matches and mismatches, different types of cross fades or harsh cuts. And you might notice up here, in the first system, there's kind of a canon. So in the dance part, 5 goes to 11, goes to 16, and 5 goes to 11, goes to 16. So you have repetition. In the music part, 16 goes to 5, goes to 11, 16 to 5 to 11. So you do have a mismatch of material that was created together and then performed separately. So that's a bit of that. Oh, so I added this morning, this detour. In Paris, I met a lot of dancers where I just asked them for a session, like, can we go to a studio and just, like, do weird stuff together? And, my friend Margarita, she's a Greek dancer living in Paris, and she introduced me to a concept called a body score, which I've never heard before. And, so what is it? She said, well, I want you to just stand there, don't have your instrument, and be passive, and experience what I'm doing to your body. And then grab your instrument and do an interpretation of it. so you can do this in real time, where when I play, you have certain cavities that are opened up for someone to manipulate. Or you could do it in a different time, where memory is also a constraint, and she can touch me anywhere I give her consent to. So we're going to watch this whole video. It's only about 4.5 minutes, but I decided to add this morning because I thought it's just really weird and cool, and I had a, yeah. Right now she's like prickling the back of my neck. She's like pinching different parts of my body. So what's the rhythm of her touches? What's the quality of it? The position? Like the shape of the movement? non sequitur, here we go. So this is a chart that explains conceptually how I've been combining musical data with movement data for a while now. So on the left side we have the dancer, and the data that comes from the dancer is produced by these chips, which can go on arms or legs or anywhere you want. You can take them to wherever. And then on the right side you have musicians. And in between them you have a human-to-human dynamic interaction. There's a Maxwell's peak patch where they connect in the digital realm through software called Max MSP, and if you're working with video, jitter. And this can produce real-time and pre-made electronic sound as well as projections. So when I learned that I was going to be studying at IRCOM, my thoughts went racing immediately. The project there is you create a piece normally for a performer and a computer, whatever that means to you. But it so happened that each year they have a different composer on some composer that's on faculty, and the composer's name is Thierry Demey, who has a very close relationship with a Belgian dancer named André de Keersmaeker. And Thierry is a multimedia artist, a filmmaker, who has worked extensively with gestures and with, I think, a more embodied performance practice. So I was very excited to work with him, and I really wanted to do a piece with dance, and this isn't typically, how do I say this? This wasn't the normal thing at IRCOM. So, of course, there's always pushback, but that's part of the job, right? So I wanted to find solutions to achieve an ideal interdisciplinary performance practice. What does that mean? I'll talk about it in a bit. To establish cohesion between live dancers, live musicians, motion-sensitive live electronics, and video projection. I didn't do video projection because my machine wasn't powerful enough. I wanted to create notation and communication solutions for all performers and explore different collaborative frameworks. So we're going to watch the piece now all the way through. It's about 9.5 minutes, and then we'll unpack each section.
Thank you.
material came out of very intense collaborative workshop sessions to create rapport between performers. It's impossible for two performers just to come to room and play this piece. There has to be some sort of relationship, trust, a sense of togetherness. It's improvisation-based materials that performers naturally embody over time. We worked together on this for months, and there was no panic in the end. Actually, we were finished, and all the other composers in my cohort were pulling their hair out. The performers here traverse boundaries of what they're traditionally expected to do. I've also never seen a cellist dance, but I got a unicorn, and she was able to do all sorts of crazy things, and it was really so. Pauline and Marie was the dancer, and I didn't want to use any music stands for this piece at all. So why do that to yourself? Dancers don't read during performance, neither do a lot of jazz musicians, neither do rock and roll musicians, and in classical music, we're kind of the only ones that have accepted this performance practice. And so I think if you're going to work with dancers, and their dancers aren't going to read, the musicians shouldn't either. For me, there's no mediation between the dancer and the audience, and for me, a music stand creates mediation. You are watching someone react to material, whereas the dancer, or the musician who is improvising, they are the material, and there's no mediation between them and the audience. And to me, it's just a million times stronger. The score for this piece is an artifact and a byproduct of the collaboration. It's not the finality. The score is less than half of the story. The score is to be studied out of time, not performed from within time, and the score references videos, and each video has a behavior in it. And I can show you. Yeah, so what is behavior? General conduct of the performers. Think of it as, I want you to go over to that person and be nice to them. So I haven't told you what to say, I haven't told you what language to say, and I just gave you a behavior. Go over there and just go be delightful. And there's a million ways you can do that. So describe behavior without an explicit script. So you create a system of limited flexibility, you grant the performer agency in the now moment. And I would rather show this in the video than describe it in the score, using high-level descriptors to infer low-level descriptors. So one of the high-level descriptors we use for the dance is move your spinal column as if it's made of concrete. And so you have this really intense metaphor that drove her to do that, and I would never attempt to write it down using Laban or any sort of movement notation. So the performance practice for this piece is more dance-oriented than music-oriented. I wasn't going to have the performers go out and bow or bow at the end. I wasn't going to do any of that. The piece starts with the sound, with the omniscient environment. The fourth wall is never broken. And how is this perceived? I didn't want the audience to know that the For me, when performers go on stage, I wonder, do they know that they're at a concert? Do they know that we're watching them? Like, is this, because it's a sense of voyeurism, right? You're watching someone behave in a strange way. Do they perceive you? Are they projecting a virtual world in the room? How private, how intimate, or how public is this? And so treating performers as characters, not musicians, but as characters. And I wanted the audience to feel like they're kind of gazing into an aquarium. The fish are unaware of the global environment. We're watching people behave naturally in their own living room as if we're just peering through a telescope. And regarding the material, the relationships drive the action. The relationships between the performers and themselves, the relationships between the performers and their respective environments, between the performers and their internal desires. The psychological states, and a lot of the material came from my own improvisational practices with performers mixing different systems of logic, which, does anyone feel audacious today? Just for, please, you can bring your chair too. So, what's your name?
Lee.
Lee, I'm Scott. So I did this exercise with the performers where I wanted to create a connection with them. So how do you create a connection between a musician and a dancer? And the first thing I did was, well, can we breathe together? Can we, we're going to do an exercise just on the breath where no nobody leads, nobody follows, but we must breathe in unison. And by breath, I mean everything that's associated with the breath. So the speed, the timbre, the quality, the meaning. And we're going to look at each other in the eye.
Okay.
And it's a short exercise, maybe like 2 to 3 minutes long. And it's going to be really weird. Very weird for me.
It's going to be extremely natural.
Yes.
I think we were born doing it.
One other thing with the breath. The breath as an audible thing. It doesn't have to be audible, but it has the potential to be. Next step would be to you increase the scope of limitation. So maybe you let the dancer, okay, you can use your right hand, and the cellist, she can use her C string, and then you combine unisons with counterpoint, and you start building from this, and you create rapport, and then, like, how did you react to this? What did you think? Just, we did, like, 2 minutes of breathing.
Did you?
I thought it was 40 seconds.
Yeah. 40 seconds?
I thought it would do something more. Yeah.
Like
or anything. I mean, just, you know. The idea is that both are leading.
Both are leading, both are following.
Okay.
Yeah. So playing with constraints and generally failing a lot. So as you can tell, the piece is in 4 sections. So we're going to watch each one individually, and then I'll dig into an analysis. That didn't work. Oh, it's the beginning. Right. Do you have to watch them again, or can I just go? You remember it, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, that's good. So the first section, just so you know, it ends once they turn and they look at each other for the first time. So you have 5 scenes. Based on mixtures and evolution of 3 behaviors. This is interrupted by taping choreography, and I can show you the videos that we used for these behaviors. That's not it. It's in here. Dance videos. Here we go. So these videos are in the score, and if another performer were to play this, they would watch these videos and try to get a sense of what they're doing. I should mention one thing. The dancer in these videos, Alice, she had to leave us halfway through the year, so we had to train. We had to ask Marie to do it and train someone new. Questions that I want the audience to ask themselves when watching the first section is: do the performers know that they're in a concert hall? Because they never break the fourth wall. Do they know the existence of each other? They never interact, but they seem to be a part of the same system somehow. There's this beeping sound that happens to control both of them, like everyone paying taxes. Or some sort of omniscient signal that you know that they're both in the same world. And is
what
there
is the fourth wall?
The fourth wall is if you go into a theater, say there's a play and one of the actors speaks directly to the audience and acknowledges that we are being watched by people. That's so you
okay.
have one, two, third wall, and the fourth wall.
So what was
you break the fourth wall
okay.
and I'm speaking directly to you.
Yes.
Yeah.
But how did it differ from other concerts? So they didn't know that they were in a concert, no?
Well, so usually when a string quartet comes out, they bow immediately, and they break the fourth wall.
Oh, but it doesn't happen always.
It's good. It shouldn't. But
yeah.
No,
so
I'm
just confused. I didn't
say it happens all the time, but and we don't really stylize these things ever. We don't talk about it all the time.
But it's like, but they do know that they are in performing a concert. Right?
Of course, they're people. Yeah.
I'm just like not getting it. So okay.
No,
yeah.
it's all right. It's like watching someone who doesn't know they're being watched.
But they do know that they are being watched.
They do know, but are they acting like it?
Well, yes. Because they do know.
Yes, they know, but they are performing a character that does not know. And so part of accepting a concert is buying into the fact that they are patterning behavior in an abnormal way.
Really?
That's how I feel about it.
Okay.
Well, we have another term in theater, which is the suspension of disbelief.
Yes.
So
mm-hmm.
you're asking the audience to
yeah.
pretend that the quartet doesn't know that they're there.
Did you have a question?
For the audience?
Yeah, I mean, so it feels like you're fed up with the traditional working relationship of classical musicians, but I mean, you know that, like, that most musicians do break the fourth wall and acknowledge the audience. Like,
yeah.
like a singer-songwriter will banter during set changes, and that's part of the performance.
Sure, that's another art form, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So, like, why don't you like that acknowledgement of the audience?
It's on a case-by-case basis.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when rock bands go on stage, like, good mornings or good evening, San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
Like, good morning, San Francisco. yeah, like, different things are appropriate for different
uh-huh.
cases. And, like, I'm a composer in the genre of contemporary performance.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, I prefer cases where the fourth wall isn't broken. It's just personal to me.
Mm-hmm.
Different cultures do things differently.
Yeah, I think maybe also the hierarchy that it creates, where you know the string quartet bows before they play, and it's kind of like, oh yes, we've graced you with our presence.
Yeah,
whereas like you know somebody bantering during set changes, it's just like, yeah, I'm here with you. There's a different connotation.
Yeah, I didn't want that at all. I know the audience is here with me.
Mm-hmm.
They came to the show, and they're in a room with closed doors. They can leave at any time.
Mm-hmm.
Did you have a question?
Yeah, in regards to this, so are you as the composer considering the venue as an active participant in the composition?
Absolutely.
Because your choice in this style, like you said, it's not always a constant choice in your composition, but in a case by case basis.
Yeah.
In this way, as an audience in this venue, watching the work through this medium, I'm imagining that, and you can tell me if my question is if this imagining is right. I'm imagining that it is also presented for the medium of video, because now there is the space of, you know, so that's just what it looks like to me. But I'm also a composer who works in video, so
yeah.
I'm coming to watch it in that way.
I'm not a video artist.
Okay.
And I use video, I just set up a camera and let it run.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so hard to document dance with video.
Mm-hmm.
And right here, we're not going to perceive it the same way as in Sankat at the Paris venue.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just like suspending disbelief of disbelief. It's like
right,
one
exactly.
step further removed.
Yeah.
So, yes.
Another thing that's interesting about this, like, layer of removal of sorts, or maybe not removal, but of like what that bubble of perception might be or something, is that I feel, and you know this might not be true for you, but that even the audience does participate in a very real way when one is improvising, you know, or like, you know, one is creating, you know, art or sound or whatever, it kind of all happens together. Without an audience, it would be very different.
Right.
So it's interesting that then that there are these scores that are kind of like focused on only certain bodies, you know, but then kind of, I don't know if this is what is the intention, but like meant to ignore a bunch of other bodies and sharing the space.
Right. I feel kind of controversial about scores that include parts of the audience.
Mm-hmm.
Because I know that when I go out to a concert, I'm really lazy. And I don't want to perform. I just want to relax or just be perturbed by art. But I don't necessarily feel like performing. I'm an active listener. But did I understand your question correctly?
No, I mean, I think that there's something to that. I think that being an active listener is in some ways taking part in that creative process.
So at least I listen to music that is written, that I know that's written differently than music that I know that is improvised. And I've had conversations with a few of you in this room about this. But when listening to improvised music and performing it, I'm listening to interactions between performers. I'm interested in mapping out live decision making and who's triggering who, who's ignoring who, who's doing their own thing, who's playing together. And I'm doing the same thing in the audience. When listening to written music, I guess I listen for more of like premeditated craft. And I'm less involved in it. To me, I know most composers aren't considering the relationships of the performers between each other as people. As musicians, yes, but as people, no. And this is just a different kind of listening. Anyone else have questions? Okay. So the electronics in part one, the electronics start the piece and they prevent the applause, and then you have this immediate Mickey Mouse motion with the dancer. And for me, that's to link the dancer to the electronic sound very strongly, and then to create this relationship and then immediately destroy it. So we ask ourselves, well, what does a dancer control? So the dancer's data drives machines, granulators, that sample the sound and reshape in real time. And these machines sample buffers or memory of cello recordings mixed with samples of everyday objects, such as like pieces of metal, small pieces of metal clicking together, or buckles or switches going off. And each scene uses a different configuration, which I mix live. So.
Where are you? I'm sorry.
I'm in the back of the hall.
Okay.
In the shadows.
You're in the shadows, but like in something like a sound booth or a light booth.
Yeah.
You can see the stage.
I can see them. Yes.
Can you see the audience?
Yes.
Okay.
The audience
is
the
booth.
It's
a booth. No.
Well, there's no booth in CNMAT.
No, it's.
But
not
it's like you're. They set up a table in the back of the audience.
Mm-hmm. You're behind the audience.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And here's, can you read this? No, not really. It's okay. This just tells you how the electronics work. So you, on the left side is the analog space. You know, you have an interactive prompt, ways of following, interpretation of human behavior. On the right, you have how the motion sensors mix with MIDI data mixing with audio data. So you have this cone in the middle, which is basically scale the gyroscope in the y direction. It comes in from 0 to 1, and I want you to scale it from 50 to 100, controlling this parameter of this machine. And you have 10, 15, 20 statements that look like that. And you have four of those. And so that creates this, and then you have my controller that scales additionally, makes one pattern louder than the other, mixes them together. And then you have the spatialization system. So how are these sounds diffused through the hall? You don't need to watch part two. Part two is when, see you later, James, is when the dancer goes behind the cellist and starts manipulating her body. So a few workshop sessions. So the performers acknowledge each other they join spaces and they contact. And you, when someone stands behind another person and puts their hand, one hand on the head, like you have a very clear position of power that gradually dissolves. And so, yes, the dancer starts manipulating the cellist, but what happens afterwards is it's kind of ambiguous, like who is directing who? And gradually we establish a multi-directional flow of energy. So you notice when the cellist, she starts tapping on the fingerboard and the dancer has it in her right hand and gets into the legs. And the form and material for this are meant to be very simple. So to give the performers confidence and room to play with constraints. So I knew that, okay, we're gonna tune the lowest string of the cello down an octave, and what that permits you to do is you can have more timbral possibilities with the bow. So if you bow it faster, the pitch goes higher, you can, like, all of your little nuances are amplified. So it was literally just that, some tapping, and then I had her bang it around the instrument a bit. And that was it.
Okay. Actually, I can show the score, because I'm projected right now. It's right here. This is the second poem I've ever written in my life. So here's the first page. Each color refers to a behavior. You have the seams here. And you kind of have loose proportions on how the behaviors are to be mixed. And kind of a loose rhythm. It's not played exactly, I don't expect it to be. But they know that, okay, when we get to the end, I want more behavior three and less of behaviors one and two. The second part is mostly text. Move the cello's head slowly with both hands, we've changed, this is really out of date. And the cellist knows to colegno tratto, do this technique on the fourth string, and it was just mostly text. The third one is pretty traditionally written out. So she just memorized this. And I didn't write the part for the dancer. She choreographed it herself, and we just worked on it together. So that part is nowhere on paper, only in video. And the last section is just tape, and the performers dance to it. And Polina had taken some dance classes. I've been swing dancing for 10 years, and I took Polina swing dancing, and she's like, okay, I think I can do this. And she has a background in, like, she's done a bit of contact improvisation, but basically we did this dance like 80 times. But there's no notation for that. Here's part three. The performers explore their own spaces, and the interactions are more interpretive and less explicit. So part three is structured to sculpt the transition between material that is improvised and stuff that is more composed, with varying levels of specificity. So how do you control the focus of a musician? So again, this is personal. For me, a musician behaves differently when they're improvising versus when they're playing written music. If you have both sections in the same piece, you can usually tell when one starts and the other stops. Sorry, when one stops and the other starts. So for instance, when you go see a jazz combo and they all play the head and then they start improvising, who's ever soloing, it's gonna get a lot more freer. The personality comes through, things aren't as rhythmically precise, things are more reactive. And everyone in the audience knows this is a solo. I wanted to try to blend these so you don't necessarily know if it's an improvisation or if it's written down. And it's really hard to control the psychology of a musician. You play this written music as if it's improvised. It's hard to write it down, you just have to work with them. Yeah, I don't want to see how the performer reacts to the material. They should be the material, so I'm trying to cover my tracks between the transitions. The form in part three is simple. I made the sound first. I'm a composer. I recorded it. I gave it to the dancer. And she choreographed it herself using elements that were previously in section one. But she takes the stage and she moves her lower body, so it's the upper body, and she provides counterpoint to the musical structure. There's less live electronics. There's more tape, which punctuates the cellist. And the cello is just a little bit of reverb, a little bit of delay, just to thicken it up a little bit. for is when they come together. I think it was quite obvious. Yeah. And here is a disruption of performance rules and new logic. So when I've been ending pieces recently, I guess it's a trope of mine where I introduce new material and all the rules that we have built up so far come crashing down. And the audience has to reevaluate, like, what's going on? Why is a cellist getting up? I thought in the program note it says she's a cellist. So what is she doing without her cello? She's walking. Has anyone seen musicians walk on stage? They're very awkward people. So just trying to establish a new system of logic, trying to establish a new way of perceiving the roles of the performers on stage, of them crashing down the boxes that we as an audience built for them. So my initial idea was to the dancer's body to have the structure of a cello somehow, whatever she's doing, and then for the cellos to bow on her body in different ways. And this didn't work. We didn't like it. So, yeah, the audience's schema of Polina is reevaluated. Cellist, the performer, what is she? Has she gone through a transformation? Why is the cellist dancing? This is a good one. Why not give Marie the cello? So, going from musician to dancer or dancer to musician, are those the same? Absolutely not. We all have bodies that are able in some degree to move. And so, are we dancers? Is that movement stylized? Going from dancer to mover is the subtraction of an object. Going from mover to dancer is the addition of an object. Controversial, because what is an object? You know, am I a musician or a dancer? And there's also this question of amateurism. So there are lots of scores that ask musicians to move, whether it's turning their heads or walking around or having facial expressions. And I'm appreciative that this art form exists, but for me, dancers spend their whole lives critically studying movement. And most musicians don't. They study how their body moves in relation to producing a sound, which is the ultimate goal. And you can see this difference very clearly if you ask a musician to walk across the stage and you ask a dancer to walk across the stage. Dancers have a certain gaze, which, do I talk about gaze? Okay, I haven't talked about gaze yet, but I think I will. So stage presence, objects, gaze, posture, and intentions. So gaze is when, I can answer that. So how do performers direct attention when they're on stage using where they're looking? So when Lee and I were breathing together, my gaze is on her and her gaze is on me. But it wasn't this. It was this. And you can see that those two, you're projecting your focus in a very different way, and everyone else was able to perceive that. Tamara? Am I doing gaze right? Do you want to correct me on anything? Or am I speaking about it correctly? Because there's a lot of literature about this that I don't understand.
I think there are a lot of different interpretations. So I know the dancer's interpretation necessarily.
Yeah.
Our focus is very important. It changes the rest of our body, like going from this to this. You can feel where your energy wants to go, and
yeah,
you can intentionally break that or do other things with it.
And all of this is perceived by the audience.
Yeah, but I wouldn't say there's one definition of gaze. There's a lot.
Yeah.
Gaze is the eye focus, though. It is the how you're focusing.
Yeah.
Like when you Google it, it'll be that. And like Tim was saying, there are different methods of gazing for performance that the audience can enter into. Like there's, for example, acute eye focus, which is a type of gaze, which is what we did. It's peripheral, that's kind of generally open, so it's more like this, and dancers kind of, different people that are working in deportment. I'm an opera singer, so we work a lot with our bodies too, so it's that eye focus kind of.
I was thinking of that, but
yeah.
Yes, musicians do that because
yeah,
singers do that. It's
singers
not
do
like
that.
The musicians don't do it.
Musicians
because
don't think about it.
Singers do think about it.
Instrumentalists, I think, is the word.
Yes.
Sorry,
yeah.
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 Yeah. Because I was really thinking
we're
about
using
that,
our bodies,
that the singers who enter the stage,
right,
be it, I mean, operatic,
yeah,
they do think about. And the thing is that the mask, right?
Right.
You have to smile with your. I took 2 years singing lessons. I don't know anything, but she was talking about. My teacher was talking about a lot of that. You know,
mm-hmm.
the thing that you have to. And I was
yeah.
thinking of maybe that's the gaze also.
That's a form of gaze.
Yeah.
So that's an
part of your heart.
Utilizing gaze technique. That's an
yeah.
that's an embodied practice, which I think is what you're saying.
Right.
Related to dancing.
And I think. Bringing gaze in with objects, I feel
mm-hmm.
like when musicians who work with objects, the object kind of prevents us or gives us a
right.
shield between us and the audience, so we don't feel like our bodies are on display.
Right.
But they are. The viola is only this big.
Mm-hmm.
So,
right.
Yeah, so you have to tread on these waters kind of lightly. Yeah, why is the cellist dancing? Why can't the... Well, if you do give dancers instruments, which I've done before, they're very creative. They don't hold, whatever. They don't hold the viola like how I've been taught to hold for 15 years. They'll like turn it over, they'll sniff it, they'll like start scratching on it. It's they don't sniff it. But they behave in a very, it's an interesting way. I should write a string quartet for four dancers. And
yeah, that would be nice.
I think there are
probably
several of them.
Yeah.
You know,
I've never seen any.
Violinist, composer David Ryder, I think he's done some work.
We should talk afterwards about this.
Yeah, sure.
So the way we made the fourth part was just creating body images. So Marie starts kind of in this pseudo cello pose, and the polina goes behind her and takes her body as if it's a human cello. But that image is quickly lost, and it gets into something much more ambiguous. And so creating a fluid abstract network of related shapes, starting with the cello. And then working on changing rhythms, heights, positions, speeds, going from unidirectional control to more ambiguous abstract control. So at the last moment, performers don't break character, the pieces end by a blackout, and then silence, the omniscient ends the piece, the performers don't have any control over it. So here's the global form. Can you read that? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The piece fluctuates between individual and the fused worlds, so it starts very individual and gradually comes together. Gradual one-way transition between the performer's control of the sound. So at the end, the performers do not control the sound, it's a tape. At the beginning, they have absolute control over it. I'll give you like 30 seconds to read this because my voice is getting the smoke, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So concluding thoughts on this piece. Can I go back to writing regular concert pieces? I might, I don't want to answer that question. Maybe, maybe not. It's not what I'm interested in at the moment, so we'll see what happens. Staff paper music stand, same thing. I want to get away from all of it. Sorry, could you do me a favor and close the blinds?
Yeah, sure.
Or close the... Thank you.
Yes, I. Okay.
Theatricality and character are definitely more things I want to explore with musicians. Because we don't think about it enough. Interdisciplinary performers, expanded performance practices, and close collaborations. I really like creating stuff with other people, with collective experimentation. I don't want to be limited by my own imagination, and I really value what happens when you get, you know, performers in the same room together who are just as nuts as you are, and you create something that none of you could have envisioned. I'm not concerned with how these projects can be reproduced. I'm not concerned with getting multiple performances. I'm done like trying to package my works in little boxes. Yes.
So are you saying that all that you are saying that you're not going to do is the concert piece? Does it belong to the concert piece?
Yeah, I think I'm done with that.
Because that's actually not that limited. I was thinking the same thing, like being the same room with the performers, doing something that you really, and the performers being the musicians,
mm-hmm.
and doing the collaboration that nobody can anticipate what's gonna come out. That's what I actually have been doing.
Yeah.
And the end result is a score, but it becomes a score through improvisation.
Right, but you never, it's not easy to ship that to different places.
It's not, because that piece has lights and I have to be there with the
electronics.
Yeah,
because the score is embodied inside different people as well.
Well, it's not, because it's written in music.
Right.
Because we found the fingerings, we found all the crazy sounds, we had the videos, we had everything. So I used the videos to write the music.
Right, and so...
With the aid of the musicians. So it's not something that is like restricted to my imagination either, because I have the videos of the performer, like you have the videos of the dancer.
Right.
And performers and things like that. So it doesn't have to be so like narrow the world of the concert pieces either, I think.
I'm just saying it's not my immediate concern.
Yes, I know, but now that you are boxing the concert pieces in this small narrow box, it's not.
I mean, pieces that you send the score to the performers, they come, they spend a day and a half with you, and then they play it.
Yes.
That kind of piece.
They can do it. They can do this piece that I wrote with the aid of the videos because it's written completely.
Yeah. I don't think it's possible with something like this.
I know, but I mean, I wrote a concert piece and we did all those things that you also did, collaborated, we made videos.
Yeah.
It's not my own imagination only.
It's their imagination.
So it's the both and the collaboration and things like that. So concert pieces do not necessarily have to be, you know,
right.
Like this.
Yeah,
they can
yeah,
be
they
like
don't.
This.
Things are more great.
Yeah.
But I think that one of the main things about your pieces, I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, is the relationship between the musicians. So that, you know, you to then, for his concerns, you know, for these types of pieces, then you would have to kind of start the process all anew with all the musicians that would perform it wherever
right.
they would, you know. It sounds to me like your piece has been created with this group of musicians in mind, and so now the other performers are going to play based on this that has already, this relationship that has already taken place,
right?
Yeah. Instead of creating new relationships within themselves and, you know, starting more of like a conceptual...
Yeah, but they do interpretation. It's not like they
sure.
are, you know...
Yeah.
As it somehow... Somehow I get the feeling that you are saying that musicians do not just have relationship with the piece, they just practice it 2 days and then it's done.
Well, anything happens during university residencies.
Yeah, but you don't have to do that.
No, but that's...
But
that's,
all
that's,
the concepts,
that's
I'm just saying that
that's
not
a dominant
every
model in
the
United States
yeah.
right
yeah.
now.
There's a spectrum.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd like to add that I hear, because I did go to a university model too, and it sounds like and because I hear you saying, I'm not going to do that anymore, I'm not interested in that anymore, I don't want to do that anymore, because, and I went through that phase too, and entered into a longer phase of independent study and creating a different model for myself and my practice. So I think that what I saw in your last, if you want to go back, yeah, in your concluding thoughts, where you're talking about interdisciplinary performance, expanding performance practices, that expansion of performance practices is actually the expansion of the relationships that then will
mm-hmm.
translate into being able to ship a piece and have a network of musicians that have a relationship with their own practice.
Mm-hmm.
Not necessarily with me or you, we need this amount of rehearsal time, but I already have a relationship with my practice of 15 years that we are comparable to be able to put a work like yours together within the same amount of time as something that's through composed.
But hopefully it gets like that.
It does get like that.
Okay.
So be encouraged.
I trust you.
Yes.
But it's also not true that the classical canon was written in a vacuum.
Exactly. It's not
Mozart and Beethoven,
exactly.
all those
they were,
pieces
they
of music were written for
in the
they,
same
they
way.
Depend on culture.
Yeah.
Depend on culture.
Exactly.
So, what's next? Right now I live in Chicago, and I'm trying to start an ensemble of musicians and dancers using live electronics with the goal of improvising 20 to 30 minute sets. This is a long-term project. I'll be going to Paris a couple of times this year for the Prototype 6 program at Royal Mont, and this is a long-term collaborative project with composers and choreographers from all over the world. And there's a festival in the Netherlands, Gaudeamus Music Week, where they will perform this, an old piece and a new piece, which I have to get started on. Then we're gonna have a coffee break, and then we'll go on to the more exciting part 3 of the presentation. So stay tuned, there will be live music, we'll make noise and move stuff. So yeah,
thank you.
Is is there any, you have some coffee? Did any musicians in the room bring instruments? But great. Anyone who's a dancer, raise your hand. Dancer. I saw you wearing a ballet sweat. Are you a dancer?
Yeah, but not today.
Can you dance with your hands?